Everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. Come and eat.
Well, shalom aleichem, spirit and truth seekers, and lovers of Yeshua the Messiah and the Torah. Welcome to another edition of Waters in the Wilderness, the teaching ministry of Hoshana Rabbah, Biblical Discipleship Resources, where we endeavor, by the grace of Yehovah Elohim, to connect the message of the gospel with his pro-Torah Hebrew roots. Hallelujah. Today we are in Parashat Achrei Mot, which, as we continue our journey through the Torah, is found between Leviticus 16, verse 1, and Leviticus chapter 18, verse 30. Three complete chapters. And as always, I'd like to let you know that we have Torah study guides available for free in PDF format that you can download from our website, hoshanarabbah.org. Go to the menu bar where it says Torah study, and you can click on that, and we'll take you to Torah studies, both adult Torah study guides as well as youth, teen, and preteen Torah study guides, ideal for homeschooling or individual study as well as group study. Both studies are suitable for that, so we encourage you to download those. And some of the things that I cover in those teachings, those written study guides, I don't cover in the videos, and vice versa. Some of the things covered in the videos, we don't cover in those. So they're complementary, but they're not repetitive necessarily. Okay, today we want to get directly into Leviticus chapter 16, start there at least. And this is the details pertaining to the ceremonies, the rituals that took place in the tabernacle of Moses on the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur. And this is so important that this particular feast day, it's a very high holy day, and it's the fifth of seven biblical feasts, and this occurs in the fall. In the fall, you have the feast of, or the Day of Trumpets, Yom Teruah, and then you have the Day of Atonements, Yom Kippur, and then you have the Feast of Tabernacles, Hag HaSukkot, or the Feast of Booths, or the Feast of Ingathering. It has several different names. And then you have the eighth day, Shemini Atzeret. And we, in other places, other times, have discussed the significance of these biblical feasts and how they relate to the second coming of Yeshua the Messiah and the order of end time events. Similarly, the fall biblical feasts of Passover and Unleavened Bread, and then the Feast of Pentecost, Shavuot, or the Feast of Weeks, relate to the first coming of Yeshua, and occur in the spring. And so, again, I have many videos and many teachings on all of these feasts and how they, what the Bible has to say about them, their historical significance, as well as their present relevance for the believer, as well as their future prophetic implications relating to the second coming, the end times, and the second coming of Yeshua and him establishing his millennial government on this earth. And eventually then that leads into the Olam Haba, the glorified saints living and reigning with Yeshua forever and ever in the New Jerusalem, on the new earth, in the new heavens. So anyway, we won't take time to get into too many details on that because, again, covered those many times before. And that's outside the discussion of this present Torah portion. But the book of Leviticus, chapter 16, talks about Yom Kippur. The whole chapter is about that. And so the first point of discussion is I'd like to compare the day of Passover or Pesach, which occurs in the spring. It's the first of the seven Moedim, or the seven appointed times of Yehovah. And I'd like to compare that with the Day of Atonement, which is the fifth, and which occurs in the fall. Now, both of these, a cursory reading of the scriptures seems to indicate that there exists overlapping similarities between Pesach and Yom Kippur because of the blood atonement ceremonies related to each of them. Each of them have to do with sacrificing of animals. It occurs on the altar outside the tabernacle in the outer courtyard of the tabernacle of Moses. And so some people would say, well, what is the point? Why two of these? If the altar of sacrifice represents the cross of Yeshua, and that's the first station that we come to in the tabernacle of Moses, that represents the cross or the first step in a believer's life, then why is step number five in this process, or the fifth biblical holiday, if you will, or Yom Kippur, why is that so focused around the Day of Atonement? And why are we revisiting the cross if we've already had our sins washed in the blood of Yeshua? Why do we need to go back to the cross? And what is the purpose of that? And that's a very good question. And it's an honest question that many people, again, a cursory understanding of the scriptures may cause one to be perplexed over. Well, if we, as I already have noted, if we recognize that the Passover occurs in the spring and Yom Kippur, or the Day of Atonement, occurs in the fall, that gives us a clue right there that there's a difference. The spring feast days, as I already noted, relate to the first coming of Yeshua, while the fall feasts relate to his second coming prophetically. It hasn't happened yet. Also, the spring feasts represent all the seven biblical feasts are steps in the walk of the redeemed believer. So, as one is coming out of the world or Egypt, exodusing out of and coming to faith in Yeshua the Messiah at one's initial salvation, when they are become a new spiritual creation, their sins are washed away, they put their faith in Yeshua, they receive the Spirit of Elohim, and then become a new spiritual creation and begin to walk out the walk of a saint or a redeemed believer or a new man in Yeshua, a new creation. There's many ways that the scripture relates us to one set apart in the world, but not of the world, but as a child in training of the Most High. Passover relates to these initial steps that one takes. But then in the fall, that is a picture of the saint who has been walking out this walk for a while, getting ready to receive Yeshua, getting ready for the second coming, getting ready to be the bride of Yeshua without spot and wrinkle, getting ready to meet at the resurrection, to meet Yeshua in the air and to become his bride. That's what the fall feast days, or at least the first couple of them, refer to and relate to and point to prophetically. So does this give you, I'm kind of trying to paint a picture here, but does this begin to show you the differences, or I might say the complementary differences between Passover and Yom Kippur? I hope the wheels are beginning to turn in your head. Let me now ask another question. If Passover represents getting our sins washed, all the sins we've committed in the past as a outside of the kingdom of Elohim, outside of a relationship with Yeshua, so we come to faith in him and he washes away, we put our faith in him in his death, burial, and resurrection, and our sins are washed away, we are baptized for the remission of sins, and we become a new creation in him. Let me ask you this question. Do you ever sin ever again? Just because you've had your past sins washed away, does that mean you will never sin again? You will never, for the rest of your entire life, you will never break any of the commandments or the laws of Elohim, because we read in 1 John 3:4 that sin is a violation of the law, the Torah. In other words, you never will lie ever again. You'll never think a wrong thought. You will never lust. You'll never break the Sabbath. You will never, not love your neighbor as you should. You never steal. You never do anything in word, thought, or deed ever again for the remainder of your life? be honest now. That's highly unlikely. Very highly unlikely. In fact, if one says they've never sinned from the day they got saved, not only are they a liar and they don't know what sin is and how pervasive it is, but they're also guilty of the sin of pride, which is the worst sin of all, according to the scriptures. So, Paul, the mighty apostle Paul, struggled with sin. He had a glorious salvation, but we read in Romans chapter 7 that he struggled with sin. That which I don't want to do, I do, and that which I do do, I don't want to do. The struggle between the soul man, the mind, the will, and the emotions, and the spirit man. That goes, that raging, warring battle that goes on inside of us. And sometimes the battle is not so difficult as other times, but it all depends on what's happening around us, the temptations, the trials, the difficulties, the struggles that we have in this world against the world, the flesh, and devil. And, you know, we will sin again. Now, hopefully, we're becoming less and less sinners, because the Bible calls us saints. The Bible calls us righteous. The righteous are scarcely saved, but we are called the righteous of Yeshua, the redeemed of Yeshua. But we still stumble along the way. And if we sin, as the Bible says, Yeshua is faithful to forgive us of our sins. If we confess our sins, he is faithful to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. And if you go read a couple verses before that, it says that everybody has sinned and everybody will continue to sin. But sinning is not a way of life. And the Bible, Yehovah does not look at you as a sinner. You are a redeemed saint, the righteous. And when you stumble, you get up, pick yourself up, dust yourself off again, and go forward, repenting of your sins, and going forward, and endeavoring by His strength and help not to repeat that sin. But we do stumble. So we need, at the end of our life, or prior to the second coming of Yeshua, whether we die in this life a natural death and then be resurrected to meet Yeshua in the air, as 1 Thessalonians 4 talks about, and 1 Corinthians 15, or whether we are alive to meet Yeshua in the air, we need to be continually staying under the blood of Yeshua. Whenever we sin, we need to go back to the cross. We need to go back outside of the tabernacle to the altar of a sacrifice outside the tabernacle and get cleansed. You know, Yeshua is preparing a bride for himself. The Father, the Ruach HaKodesh, the Spirit of Elohim, is preparing a bride for Yeshua, the Son. And we must, we must be preparing ourselves to enter the millennial kingdom, preparing ourselves to be a bride without spot and wrinkle, which means that sometimes we get soiled, we get dirty from the world, the flesh, and the devil around us, and sometimes we stumble. So we have to keep going back to the cross, back to the cross, back to Yeshua, and staying under the blood. Yes, our past sins were washed away. You know, this is an important point, because Paul says this in Romans chapter, I believe it's chapter 3 or 4, is our past sins, chapter 3, verse 26, actually, verse 25, whom Elohim sent, well, let me read this up, being freely just, well, let's read the verse 23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of Elohim, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Messiah Yeshua, whom Elohim set forth as a propitiation or an atonement by his blood through faith to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance Elohim has passed over the sins that were previously committed. Our past sins. When we repent, we can't repent of future sins. That's impossible. We can only repent of sins that we have committed. How can you repent for something you haven't done yet? You don't even know if you will do it. So when we come to faith in Yeshua, we repent of our past sins. The slate is wiped clean. He pays the price for those past sins with his blood. And now we start fresh. And each time we sin, that is now a new past sin that we need to repent of and get under the blood. And we need to go through our life continually repenting of sins as we commit them, as the Ruach HaKodesh, the Spirit of Elohim, convicts us of sin, righteousness, and judgment. And as we study the Word and the Word of Elohim and see something that, well, we didn't realize it was a sin and now we are convicted and we need to repent of it, and we then go and do the right thing. So this is an ongoing process. So it's our past sins. And then when we get a little bit further down the road in our spiritual walk, we need to repent of our past sins again. And hopefully, we're sinning less and less. We're becoming more like Yeshua, walking in His Spirit, not conformed to the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, the world, the flesh, and the devil, in other words. In fact, we read here in Revelation 12:11, it says, speaking about the end time saints, let's start in verse 10. Then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now salvation is strength, and the kingdom of our Elohim and the power of His Messiah have come. For the accuser of the brethren has accused them before our Elohim day and night and has been cast down. And they, the saints, overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they did not live their lives unto death. So what we have up in heaven is we have a court. It's like a court of law. And the accuser of the brethren, that's Satan, is accusing us. Just we see the veil, if you will, pulled back. And we see a little bit of that in the first chapter of the book of Job, where the accuser of the brethren, Satan, was up there accusing Yehovah, before Yehovah, accusing Job before Yehovah of things that, you know, that he was trying to... thought that Job was a sinner in. And anyway, so the accuser of the brethren is up there constantly accusing us before Elohim. And if we have sinned and we have not gotten that sin of the blood of Yeshua, then he has legal grounds to accuse us. Hey, you know, so-and-so, Natan Lawrence did this. You know, he lusted after that woman, or he lied, and the devil then can throw that in the face of Elohim, the just judge of the universe, and say, hey, you know, you shouldn't, you know, he has sinned and he's fallen short of the glory, as we read here in Romans chapter 3. And, you know, he stands guilty before you. But then, and Yehovah may be justified in punishing me or whatever. Legally speaking, because of the sin I've committed, because every sin has a punishment. And yet, if I have repented of that sin, and I've gotten that sin under the blood of Yeshua, then Yeshua, who's at the right hand of the Father, will say, no, my blood has covered that past sin. It is no longer a legal issue. I paid for it. So you are a false accuser, Satan. Get down. And that's how the saints overcome, by the blood of the Lamb, by living righteous lives and repenting of their sins and not letting the sins hang out there, so that now it's a legal point where they have violated the laws of Elohim, and the enemy can, like a prosecuting attorney or a prosecutor can, who is bringing charges against a defendant in a court of law, he can say, well, you know, he did this, he murdered, he drove intoxicated, drunk, or whatever the crime may be, and before the judge, and then says, yeah, okay, right, you know, this is the penalty. But then, in the case with Yeshua, he's paid the penalty, because I have repented of my sins, and now that penalty has been paid. Hallelujah. That's how it works. So the Day of Atonement is, and that's how we overcome, one of the ways that we overcome, the main way, I might say, that we overcome the accuser of the brethren. And that passage there in Revelation chapter 12, verses 10 and 11 is very important to remember. So we've got to stay under the blood of Yeshua continually, every day, under the blood. And if we know we've committed sin, we must confess our sins. So as we come to the end of our lives, as we come closer to the second coming of Yeshua, we must repent of our sins and stay under the blood of Yeshua. And that way the enemy doesn't have anything on us, and His mercy and His grace will cover us. Hallelujah. So that's why Yom Kippur is a picture of the bride of Yeshua preparing herself in robes of righteousness, preparing herself for the second coming of Yeshua. In fact, we see this a little bit in Revelation 19, a scripture which many of you are familiar with. It says here, let us be glad, verse 7, let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come and his wife has made herself ready. How does she make herself ready? By staying under the blood of Yeshua, by walking as saints, as holy ones, as set apart kadosh ones, obeying, loving Yeshua by keeping his commandments, following him, walking in righteousness. His wife has made herself ready. Remember the parable of the 10 virgins in Matthew 25? Five were ready, five were not. And in verse 8 of Revelation 19, and to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean, bright, for the linen is the righteous acts of the saints. So what are the righteous acts of the saints? Well, it's obeying Torah. Righteousness. All thy commandments are righteousness, 119:172. Another act of righteousness is to have faith in Yeshua. Where our righteousness falls short, his righteousness will cover us, imputed righteousness, and our sins will be washed away in by his blood, and he will cover us in his righteousness. We need to live righteously, and we also need to stay under the blood of Yeshua so his righteousness can be attributed to us. And our good deeds will not earn us salvation. They will earn us rewards in the kingdom or crowns, but not salvation. Only the blood of Yeshua. We got to stay under that blood. And when we stumble, we need to get back up, get under the blood, and go forward and stop the mouth of the accuser of the brethren. It says then, these are the righteous acts of the saints. Then he said to me, verse 9, write, blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And not everybody's going to be in the marriage supper of the Lamb. Not every saved saint will be in the marriage supper of the Lamb. There were five foolish virgins that didn't make it in there. They were saved, but they didn't make it in there. And Revelation or Matthew 5:19 says that there are levels of rewards. Yeshua said there will be those who are the least in the kingdom. Those who obey him and keep his commandments and teach others to do so will be called the greatest in the kingdom. Those who do not follow his commandments and do not teach others, and so they're walking a lower level spiritual, will be called least in the kingdom. All right, so there you have it. Passover is about initial salvation, having your sins washed and coming to faith in Yeshua. Atonement is about preparing, washing your garments in the blood of Yeshua, walking out righteousness, staying under the blood, overcoming the accuser of the brethren, and putting on robes of righteousness through faith in Yeshua, through obedience, and going forward, ready to meet Yeshua in the air. All the time, your entire life, from beginning to end, staying under the blood of Yeshua. Hallelujah. I hope that was a blessing to you. Now let's go down to Leviticus 16, verse 4. Leviticus 16, verse 4. And it talks here about the... we're not going to go into a lot of details on the ceremonies that happened on the day of Yom Kippur here, chronicled in Leviticus 16. There is so many details in here. We could do many, many teachings, and I have plumbed those depths in other teachings that I've done. This is just kind of a going over skimming over the top of the waves. There's no way. I mean, it'd be hours and hours. And be honest with you, I don't know. No, I don't think any one person can know all the truths that are found in this passage of Scripture or anywhere else in the Bible. It takes many teachers with many revelation and years of understanding to understand all these things. And we're learning new things all the time. So I'm just sharing with you a few things that I have learned along the way that I hope will be a blessing to you. So in Leviticus 16, verse 4, we see the high priest Aaron shall come, verse 3, Aaron shall come into the holy place with the blood of a young bull as a sin offering and of a ram offering as a burnt, and a ram as a burnt offering. Verse 4, he shall put the holy linen tunic and the linen trousers on his body. He shall be girded in with linen sash, and with linen tunic he shall be attired. So he put on full, complete white clothing. His normal priestly garments were put aside, and he put on all white garments. And that's, of course, a picture of the saint coming before Yeshua, all dressed in white linen robes of righteousness. But what I want to focus on here is that he had to take off his everyday clothes and put on special sanctified white priestly garments in order to enter into the holy Holy of Holies, which is where he went once a year, bringing in blood and incense. You come into the and of course, the Holy of Holies was a picture on earth there of the throne room of Elohim, the very presence of Elohim, where the Ark of the Covenant was, which is a picture of the throne of Elohim and the glory cloud, which was over the top of that. That's where Elohim dwelt, and that's a picture of coming in his presence before, that is, us coming into the presence of Elohim, into his throne, following the proper protocols. So the priest would come with blood and with incense. Incense, we've discussed this before, is a picture of the prayers of the saints and of worship and is of praise. We see that in many places. I did a whole teaching on that recently. You can scroll back through the video catalog here, the list of videos on this website, a YouTube channel, and you can find that. I did a whole teaching on that. But Revelation 5:8 and 3 says, and 8 verse 3 says that the prayers of the saints, the worship, the prayer are like golden bowls of incense, full sweet smelling incense coming up before Yehovah. So we must enter his presence through the blood of Yeshua with praise and worship and prayer. You cannot come into the presence of the creator of the universe any other way. And so when Moses went in on the day on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, this is how he went in. And he took off his everyday clothes and he put on special robes of righteousness, if you will. And this is a prophetic, there's a prophetic spiritual lesson in this for us. Before we can be fit for Jehovah's spiritual service, we must put off the old carnal man, represented by the clothes, the everyday clothes that the high priest wore. And we must put on the new, redeemed, sanctified, spiritual man. Let's read a couple scriptures that talk about this. Ephesians 4, verse 22. Ephesians 4, 22. It says here, that you put off concerning your former conduct the old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man which was created according to Elohim in true righteousness and holiness. That's Ephesians 4, 23-24. And then Colossians 3, 9 and 10. Let's go there real quickly. Colossians 3, 9 and 10 says, do not lie one to another, since you have put off the old man with his deeds and have put on the new man who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created him. So we have to put off the old man and be conformed to the likeness and image of Yeshua the Messiah. So that's what putting off these old habits, the old sinful habits, the old carnal way, dying to self and becoming alive to Elohim, following the Spirit, being washed in the water of the Word, being washed under the blood of Yeshua, and putting our faith in Him, and in following the Word and the Spirit and the life of Yeshua as an example. So the linen garments is prophetic symbolism for walking in righteousness, or the robes of righteousness, which are the righteous deeds of the saints. Revelation 19, verse 8, which we just read a few moments ago. Hallelujah. So I want to encourage you, put on the robes of righteousness. It's an uphill battle fighting against the world, the flesh, and the devil. This tidal wave of evil, this onslaught, is constantly arrayed against us, trying to take us off of the path of truth and righteousness, that straight and narrow path that Yeshua said, I am the way that leads to the Father in heaven. I am the way, the truth, and the life. We've got to stay on that path, and we've got to work hard and cry out to Him for help and be repenting of our sins all the time, every day if necessary, as often as we sin, and be constantly going forward in our spiritual walk. Leviticus 16:7, relating to the Day of Atonement, has a very curious ceremony that involves two goats. I'm going to read this. We're not going to read the whole portion, but just the beginning of it. Verse 6, Leviticus 16, Aaron shall offer the bull as a sin offering, which is for himself, and make atonement for himself and for his house. Then he shall take the two goats and present them before Yehovah at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. Then Aaron shall cast lots for the two goats, one lot for Yehovah and the other lot for the scapegoat. And Aaron shall bring the goat on which the Yehovah's lot fell and offer it as a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell to be the scapegoat shall be presented alive before Yehovah to make atonement upon it and to let it go as a scapegoat into the wilderness. So this is the story of the scapegoat and the other goat that was sacrificed. And over the years, I've read a lot of interpretations about what people think the spiritual prophetic significance of this is. And after many years of study, I'd like to share with you what I believe that it represents. And I hope this witnesses in your spirit to be the truth. I'm not saying I have all the revelation or knowledge about this curious subject, but I think that what I'm about to present to you certainly lines up with the revelation in the rest of the scriptures. So why are there two goats? Do both goats represent Yeshua the Messiah, his atoning work at the he accomplished at the cross, or does each goat represent a different facet of this work, or do some people in the term the scapegoat is the Hebrew word Azazel? Some see a satanic implications that have led them to believe that the Azazel or Azazel goat actually represents Satan, the one who first tempted man to sin and the one who first sinned that we read about in the Bible. And so some people believe that that goat is a picture of him upon whom the sins of the world were put. And so that's the question we want to ask ourselves. This idea that the Azazel or Azazel goat points to Satan is, quite frankly, if you study it, it's at its root is Jewish folklore that is not rooted in Scripture. So I do not accept that interpretation. And we're going to talk about this. But verse 10 of this chapter we just read in Leviticus 16 says that the Azazel goat made atonement for the people. But the goat on which the lot fell to be the scapegoat shall be presented alive before Yehovah to make atonement upon it. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about this in just a few minutes, but I don't see any place in the scripture where Satan ever makes atonement for our sins. That is, to me, blasphemous. So I reject the idea that this goat represents Satan. Oh, there's only one person that made atonement for our sins, and that's Yeshua the Messiah, and that's throughout the scriptures. If anybody doesn't believe that, then you probably don't want to continue watching this video. You may as well turn it off and go get your ears tickled some other place. Because that's what we teach, that's what we believe. And that's the only one who has the power to redeem you from your sin. And nobody else, or no other entity, no other spiritual entity, has the power or the legal authority to do that. Only Yeshua the Messiah. That's what we preach here, and that's what the Bible teaches. From Genesis, yes, from Genesis to Revelation. So, 1 John 3:4 says that, or 3:14, we see Yeshua likening himself to a serpent to the serpent on the cross that Moses lifted up. So I'm going to explain that a little bit more, but maybe that will give you an idea of what this, what this Azazel goat maybe represents. But we know from Isaiah 53, verse 53, 6 and 10, that Yeshua became man's sin offering. Satan never did that. Never, never, never. The scripture does not present that. Let's read that. Isaiah 53, what did I say here? 6 and 10. Isaiah 53, 6 and 10. And all we like sheep have gone astray and have turned everyone to his own way. And Yehovah has laid on him, that's the Messiah, the iniquity or the sin of us all. And verse 10, yet it pleased Yehovah to bruise him. He has put him to grief when you make his soul an offering for sin. So Yeshua's soul, Yeshua poured his life out at the cross. We see that prophesied about in Isaiah 53. And this is how in Genesis 3:15, that prophecy that was made to the serpent, that the seed of the woman, that prophecy about Yeshua, would bruise, and not bruise, but crush the head of Satan. And in Colossians 2:15, we read that Satan, that Yeshua triumphed over Satan, making a mockery of him when Satan thought that he had defeated Yeshua at the cross, and Yeshua resurrected from the grave, literally defeated Satan, defeated the power of death, which is really Satan's only power is death. And let's read that, Ephesians 2:15. And having disarmed principalities and powers, and he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. That's Yeshua, speaking about Yeshua and his victory over death and over Satan, over hell, and all of those things, the grave at the cross. And then in 1 Corinthians 15:54, another really powerful scripture that talks about how Yeshua redeemed us from the power of death, hell, and the grave. 1 Corinthians 15:54 says, "So when this corruptible," speaking about the resurrection of the dead at the second coming of Yeshua, "so when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written," quoting from Isaiah, "death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, but the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to Elohim who gave us the victory through our Master Yeshua the Messiah." So this is how we have the victory over Satan, death, the grave, and sin. Now let's talk a little bit more about the scapegoat, because he was sent away into the wilderness. And what does this represent? Well, as I said, it does not represent Satan, because as I just noticed in Leviticus 16:10, we read, "But the goat on which the lot fell for Azazel shall be set alive before Yehovah to make atonement over him, to send him away for Azazel into the wilderness." So, who made atonement for our sins? Satan or Yeshua? Well, there's no place in the scripture that says Satan ever made atonement for our sins. Again, that would be blasphemy. That would be attributing the work that Yeshua did to the devil. And that is one of the biblical definitions for blasphemy. Of Yeshua being our atonement, the scripture says in Romans 5:11, "And not only so, but we also enjoy in Elohim through our Master Yeshua the Messiah, by whom we have now received the atonement." Or Hebrews 1:3, "Who being the brightness of his glory," speaking of Yeshua, "and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high." Or Hebrews 7:27, "Who needeth not daily as those high priests to offer up sacrifices first for his own sins," which is what the high priest was doing on the Day of Atonement there in Leviticus 16, "and then for the people," again, this is what the high priest did, "for this he," as Yeshua did once, "when he offered up himself as a sin offering." Or Hebrews 9:26, "For then must he often," that is the high priest, "have suffered since the foundation of the world, but now once in the end of the world hath he," Yeshua, "appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself." So in Leviticus 16:21, we see that the high priest, actually, let's read that. "And Aaron shall lay both his hands on the head of the live goat, confess over it all the iniquities of the children of Israel, and all their transgressions concerning all their sins, putting them on the head of the iniquity, and shall send it away into the wilderness by the hand of a suitable man." The goat shall bear on itself all their iniquities to an uninhabited land, and he shall release the goat into the wilderness. So this ceremony took place, and it was like a transference of all the sins of the people onto the head of this goat, who then became the guilty party, if you will, in place of the children of Israel, and was put on this innocent goat. Animals are innocent, they can't sin. And the innocent becomes the sin bearer. And of course, who could not deny that this is a perfect picture of Yeshua? And he was hanging on the cross. Yehovah Elohim, the Father, laid all of our sins upon Yeshua, not upon Satan, on Yeshua. And then this Azazel goat represents the entire removal of sin's defilement from the camp of Israel into the wilderness. It's like, get that sin out of here. And we see a picture of that in Psalm 103. Where verse 12, where Yehovah says, "I will remove your sins as far as the east is from the west." Go read that. Psalm 103, verses 1 through 3. A very beautiful picture of what is taking place here, and of what Yeshua promised, what was promised Yeshua would do at the cross, and which we now look back and see that he did do for us. Psalm 103, verse 1, "Bless Yehovah, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his Kadosh name. Bless Yehovah, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies." And it goes on to say, verse 11, "For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. As far as the east is," verse 12, "as far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed our transgressions from us." So this is a promise that we have been given, and it is a reality to those whose past sins have been forgiven. When we repent of any sin we've done, they're forgiven, and he forgets our sins and removes them from the east as far as the west, which is infinity. That's how much he forgives us. I mean, that number is infinity. That's the power of the blood of Yeshua. Now we read in Leviticus 16:22, "And he," the goat, "shall bear upon him all their iniquities into a land not inhabited, and he shall let the goat go in the wilderness." So again, there are numerous scriptures in the Bible referring to Yeshua bearing our sins, taking them away from us. We read Leviticus or Isaiah 53 verse 6, we'll do it again, "All we like sheep have gone astray, we have turned everyone to his own way, and Yehovah hath laid on him the iniquity of us all." Isaiah 53 12, "Therefore I shall divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sins of many, and made intercession for the transgressors." And Hebrews 9:28, so Messiah was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. Or 1 Peter 2:24, who his own self bear our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes we are healed. So I believe, that's what I believe about the Azazel goat, but there is a hint of a secondary meaning as well. Because again, Azazel, according to Jewish folklore, can be a picture of a satanic, demonic entity. So what is going on here? What is this kind of subtext of this scripture all about? Well, I believe many years ago, Yehovah revealed to me that's a picture also of Yeshua, but it also is an indirect picture of Satan. Before you turn this off, let me explain, because Yeshua himself explains this. So it doesn't outrightly represent Satan, but Yeshua while hanging on the cross represented sin in its totality and its extreme, and for a brief moment took on the image of the serpent himself. And Yeshua said that he wasn't the serpent, but he took on the image of that, if you will. In fact, in John 3:14, Yeshua, the red letters in your Bible, is telling Nicodemus, quote, "And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up." So remember when the children of Israel sinned against Elohim and he sent fiery serpents among them to kill many of them? And when the people cried out to be delivered from the bite of sin, if you will, or the serpent's bite, Yehovah told Moses to construct a bronze serpent, which he lifted up on a pole. When the people looked on it, they were healed. And that's a picture, a Hebraic or a biblical metaphor for Yeshua dying on the cross. Yeshua wasn't Satan. He wasn't the serpent. But for that moment, when he took all the sins of the world upon himself, for that moment, he bare the sins and he became sin, the embodiment of sin, which is a serpent, is a biblical picture for Satan. So he's not Satan, but it's a picture of Satan, the adversary. And we know that Satan is likened many, many places to a serpent. Genesis 3, verse 1, 2, 4, 3, 14, and 15, and Revelation 12, verse 9, and 20, verse 2. So, I'm not the only one that has this understanding. Both Adam Clark and Matthew Henry, very well-known, excellent, for the most part, Christian commentators. Matthew Henry lived in the, I believe, in the late 1700s. Adam Clark lived in the mid to late 1800s. Both their commentaries say that both goats refer to a different aspect of Yeshua's atonement. Henry says, and I quote, "Thus Yeshua," he says Jesus, I put Yeshua in there, "was prefigured by the two goats, which both made one offering. The slain goat was a type of Messiah dying for our sins. The scapegoat, a type of Messiah," or he says Christ, "rising again for our justification, after which the entrance into heaven, which Messiah made for us, is here typified by the high priest's entrance in the most holy place." And that's his commentary without any references, Hebrews 9:7. So this is, I believe that both goats are different aspects of Yeshua's sin atonement. Also, one other possible explanation, and we could have several different truths going on here at once. But when Adam and Eve fell, they brought two deaths, not one, into play. A spiritual death, which is their sins separated them spiritually from Elohim. It broke the relationship, and that brought on spiritual death. But then, at the end of their lives, they died physically. So there was a physical death. The wages of sin is death. Wages of sin is both physical death and spiritual death. When we sin, it cuts us off from Elohim. And also, if our sins remain unatoned for, we will not only be spiritually cut off from Elohim forever, but we will remain physically dead forever as well. We will not have eternal life. So there's two things going on. And there's this idea that one of these one of these atonements, one of these goats represented spiritual death and one represented physical death. Since man is both spirit and body, he's spirit, soul, and body, but he has a spirit, and that's the part that goes, back to heaven when we die. Our soul, man, our mind, will, and emotions, that dies when our physical bodies go. Since man is both spirit and body, the two goats could represent Yeshua's atonement, both for our physical and our spiritual death. So our physical death would be the goat that was slain before Jehovah, and our spiritual death represents the goat wandering in the wilderness, representing Yeshua is alive and atones for our sins as we journey through our wilderness of life. So there could be several rich meanings here, and there may be other meanings too that we have not yet discovered, but my best understanding, that is what these two spiritual goats represent. And again, it's a beautiful picture, as I see it, of Yeshua the Messiah and his work on the cross for us, and his continuing work at the right hand of the Father for those, and the beneficiaries of which are those who put their faith and their trust in him to cleanse them of their past sins, and those that stay under the blood of Yeshua, and those that walk in truth and righteousness under the blood, protected from the accuser of the brethren. Hallelujah. And I pray that all of you watching this video know the reality of Yeshua and how he has redeemed us from our sins. And if we will confess him, confess our sins, repent of our sins, and put our faith and trust in him, and then stay under the blood, walk with him, and continue to love him and serve him, not only as our Savior, but as our Master, as our Lord, to the very day, the very last day that we die. Next, we want to turn our attention to Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11. This is probably one of the most important scriptures in the Bible that points forward to Yeshua the Messiah and his atoning death on the cross. And it helps us really to, in a sense, understand the entire Levitical sacrificial system and how it all points forward to Messiah Yeshua. 17 verse 11, "For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make atonement for your souls, for it is the blood that makes atonement for the soul." Now, the ancient Israelites had, under this Levitical sacrificial system, every time they sinned, they had to pay a price. They had to make an offering. They had to sacrifice an animal or pay some sort of a price. Pretty soon, if you were a really bad sinner and you had a lot of animals, you wouldn't have much of a flock left. You would be impoverished, because a person's wealth in those days was measured largely by the number of animals in their flock, and you'd be impoverished. You just couldn't live. And you, not only was it your wealth, it was your bank account, but it was your food, your milk, your leather, your wool. You used the animal for your daily life, and it was very important to you. Your survival was dependent on having animals. And so the life of the flesh is in the blood. And so you constantly had to keep sacrificing animals or paying some sort of a penalty every time you sin. Thankfully, we learn from, as we progress in the scriptures, that pointed forward to Yeshua's atoning death on the cross, and that he was sacrificed once and for all for our sins. So we don't have to bring a sacrifice to offer on the altar every time we sin. Yeshua is our sacrifice that all of these animals pointed to. And because Yeshua made us, he is the creator, his life is worth more than all of our lives put together. That's why one man's life could be worth more than all of the people of the world, because he was the one that created us, and the creator is more valuable qualitatively and quantitatively than everything that he ever created. So let's talk about this concept, the life is in the blood. Long before modern science confirmed this in the 17th century, Yehovah reveals that in the Torah that the life of the flesh is in the blood. You cannot live very long without the blood in your body. So Leviticus 17:11 is crucial scripture theologically regarding the blood atonement. Presently, the Jewish religion offers no hope for its followers in the light of this passage. Here is a scripture from the Torah that specifically states that the shedding of blood, that there is no atonement for sin except through the shedding of blood. And I understand, with all due respect to my Jewish brethren, they have read the scriptures and they've seen that the sacrificial system is now null and void. In other words, it doesn't exist anymore. It was effectively rendered inoperable when the at the Jerusalem destruction of the Jerusalem temple in 70 AD. And so they've read the scriptures, and correctly so, and seen that there are other forms of sacrifice, the sacrifice of praise, prayer of our lips, of doing charitable deeds, and these things. Basically, charitable deeds, prayer, and giving to the poor, and obedience to Yehovah, are acts of worship, and and replace the sacrificial system in a you know, and the Bible says that. But, and that's where they have camped. But they also have forgotten, or they have refused to acknowledge the fact that at the same time, while the sacrificial system pointed toward human beings becoming a living sacrifice through prayer, through praise, through charitable deeds, through worship, through obedience to his commandments, but they also point forward to the Messiah, the suffering servant, who would die for our sins. And they have rejected that aspect of the Levitical sacrificial system. And we know that the Jewish leaders of the New Testament church were keen to understand that. And we see that in the apostolic scriptures, the writings of the apostles, and it's no better explained anywhere than in the book of Hebrews. And this is a truth, again, that our Jewish brothers have rejected. The day is coming when they will look upon him whom they pierced. Yes, Yeshua at his second coming, it says in Zechariah, and they will put their faith in him. But most don't have their faith in him yet. Some have, hallelujah, but most have not. But they do not have any blood atonement. They have no salvation. There is no salvation in prayer, in charitable giving, in mitzvot or deeds. So prayer would be tefillah in Hebrew. Charitable deeds would be tzedakah. And then, you know, helping the poor and that kind of thing, giving charitably. And then obedience to the commandments would be mitzvot. There is no salvation in that. Yes, once we are saved, we are called to do those things, but that's not how we are saved. That's what we do because we are saved, not to get saved. And this is where they miss it. There's only one way to get saved, to have eternal life in the kingdom, and that's your faith in Yeshua, the Lamb slain from the foundation of the earth, and put your faith in the Messiah, who all that whole sacrificial system and Isaiah 53 and many other places point forward to. So they, the Jewish, our Jewish brothers, put their faith in their own works instead of in the Messiah. And there is no salvation in our works. Those are the things, again, I got to emphasize this. Prayer, praise, worship, good deeds, and obedience to the commandments are what we do because we are saved, because that Lamb, Yeshua, who came to fulfill all the sacrificial system, he came and died on the cross for us to atone for our sins, and that's what saves us, not our good works. The importance of the blood of the Lamb in the atonement for our sins, as well as in overcoming sickness and the powers of hell, cannot be overemphasized. The blood of Yeshua is a central theme of the gospel message. In fact, there are more than 50 references to it in the testimony of Yeshua. Half of them are found in the book of Hebrews. We see such terms as the blood of the Lamb, the blood of Messiah, the precious blood of Messiah, the blood of the everlasting covenant, redemption through Messiah's blood, the blood of his cross, communion of the blood of Messiah, faith in his blood, and purchase in his blood. We see these terms used in the New Testament, or the sprinkling of his blood. I mean, it goes on and on. So the reality, I want to ask the question, is the reality of the blood of Yeshua central to your faith walk? How so? If not, why not? There is no redemption for the soul of man, for the sin of man, outside the blood of Yeshua. We read again, Leviticus 17, verse 11. For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that makes atonement for your souls. It is the blood of Yeshua who died on the cross that paid the death penalty, the penalty for our sins. The wages of sin is death, as it says in the book of Romans. The soul that sinneth, it shall die, as it says in the book of Ezekiel. There is a death penalty for sin, and only Yeshua took that death penalty away. Go read about it, starting in Hebrews chapter 9, and read all the way through, actually 8 through, well, 9 through like 10. 9 and 10 are the places that really talk about this. And his work that he did as our great high priest, actually that starts in chapter 7. And it picks up again in 8. But read that whole passage of Hebrews, and you will see what he did for us, and praise his name. You too can have salvation if you'll put your faith and trust in his blood that he shed. Blood, again, typifies him giving his life in exchange for our sinful lives, giving us his life and washing away our sins so that we can have his righteousness, so that the just judge of the universe, the Father in heaven, sees us through the blood of Yeshua and not all the sins that are against us, which have been washed away. And therefore, because our sins have been washed away, we can have eternal life if we have faith in Yeshua and walk in his ways. Human sacrifice and abortion. This is not something that just happened among the ancient heathens living thousands of years ago. It is something that happens today. And the Torah, the Bible, addresses this. In Leviticus 18, verse 21, Leviticus 18, 21, it says, actually we're going to back up and start in verse 19. And you also, you shall not approach a woman to uncover her nakedness as long as she is in her customary impurity or during her menstrual period. Moreover, you shall not lie carnally with your neighbor's wife to defile yourself with her, and you shall not let any of your descendants pass through the fire of Moloch or to Moloch, nor shall you profane the name of your Elohim. I am Yehovah. This passing your children through the fire of Moloch. Moloch was an ancient Canaanite, actually a god of the, I think it was the Moabites, but the people who lived in the Promised Land. And it was an ancient god to which they would sacrifice their children in the hopes of prosperity and favorable blessings upon the people. And we see that the worship of Baal or Baal and the worship of Moloch went hand in hand. The Canaanite deity was Baal or Baal, and they were basically the same god. And by appeasing these gods, these pagan demon gods, the people in the land of Canaan, that the Israelites, when they were coming into Canaan, Yehovah told them to destroy these people that were basically devil worshippers and were sacrificing your children by making them pass through the fire. And passing through the fire was not just a matter of you know, you had two flames on either side burning and you walked down the middle with your child. No, actually, they had an altar. There was an altar that was made of, it was made in the shape of their god Moloch, and it was made out of cast iron, and it was lit on, there was a fire inside of it, and it was lit red hot with his arms outstretched, and these pagans and these heathens would literally put their children into the fire, and they'd be burned as an offering to this demon god. Now, it's very interesting that this scripture occurs right after this prohibition against lying carnally with your neighbor's wife or committing adultery. There are many people that are sexually promiscuous in our day and age, as there were then, as there always have been. And often, the fruit of sexual promiscuity is unwanted pregnancies. And guess what a lot of people in our day and age do? Same thing that happened back then when there were unwanted pregnancies. And we didn't really want this kid. This is an embarrassment. This is a shame. This is a child that's a fruit of a incestuous or an adulterous or a fornicating, you know, sex before marriage situation. Let's get rid of it. It's not wanted. I wanted to have fun, have sexual pleasure with this woman over here. Wasn't expecting to get a child out of it. And so let's conveniently sacrifice this child, which is nothing more than another mouth to feed, another consequence of my sin that I don't want to live with, and a financial responsibility and all of that. And they would just sacrifice their children in the name of religious worship to this God. The same thing that happens today in what's commonly called abortion. People mess around outside of marriage, have babies, and they sacrifice them at the abortion clinic. Kill them. Murder them. Slice them up like a sacrifice and pull them out of the body of the woman. Burn them like with chemicals to kill them inside of the womb of the mother. Just like burning them in the fires of Moloch. Yehovah calls this an abomination. This is the Bible is against that. In fact, we need to read, in addition to this, Exodus 21:22, another what we might call pro-life scripture. Now, this doesn't have to do with making your children pass through the fire, getting rid of unwanted pregnancies, but this has to do with the value that Yehovah places on the sanctity of life of the unborn or the preborn that's still in the womb of the mother. Leviticus 21, verse 22, if a man fight and hurt a woman with child so that she gives birth prematurely, yet no harm follows, he shall surely be punished according as the woman's husband imposes on him, and he shall pay as a judge determines. If any harm follows, then you shall give life for life, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, hand for hand, foot for foot, burn for burn, wound for wound, stripe for stripe. In other words, the punishment shall meet the crime. So, if a man is fighting with a woman and it causes the baby inside of her to die, then he shall pay with his life. That's the judgment. In other words, the penalty for abortion is a death sentence under the Mosaic law. Now, many people have had abortions and they've come to faith in Yeshua. And when we come to faith in Yeshua the Messiah, all of our sins that we have done ignorantly, unknowingly, before we were saved, they can be forgiven. If we sin willfully after we have saved and been saved and we murder, abort our baby, I'm not saying there isn't any forgiveness for that, but the Bible says that willful sin there is no forgiveness for. So those that do this knowing better, they're taking their lives in their hands. I'm not their judge, but they need to be very careful. This is a very serious crime. It brought on the death penalty according to Yehovah. But the Bible is definitely pro-life. And the penalty for infanticide was death. As I have noted, the murder of innocent children is perhaps one of the greatest sin that any nation can commit. Abortion is a form of child sacrifice. And many ancient cultures, such as the Aztecs, the Incas, the Phoenicians, the Canaanites, the pre-Islamic Arabs, practiced infanticide. Yes, they would go around and have premarital or extramarital sex Or and then the fruit of that would be babies that would be born that were unwanted, and then they devised satanic religious systems that would quench their guilt, salve their guilt when they justify the death, the murder of these babies by offering them up to these false demonic gods. And of course, Satan is the one that wants to destroy humanity. He will devise religions that sanction and that justify the religion or justify the murder of babies, even as abortion clinics and the abortionists of our day have all kinds of rationales to justify the murder of babies. And you hear it all the time. And I'm not going to go through that demonic litany. But there is guilt and there is shame which comes on people when they murder their babies. And they live with that guilt and that grief and that shame. And nothing they can do will ever take that away if they are honest with themselves. The only thing that can take that away is the forgiveness and the mercy, is repentance for that sin, and then the forgiveness and the mercy of Yeshua. So if you have been guilty of this crime, you need to repent, turn from it, never do it again, and live inside of the laws that Elohim has given us with regard to the governed sexuality, human sexuality, and never ever do this again. Go forward, have your sins, your guilt, your shame washed away, and miraculously there is hope. If you have committed this sin, just like any other sin, it can be forgiven. But what are those people who go and do it again and again and again, and they harden themselves off? And for those people, it's likely there is no forgiveness. There is no repentance possible. They have become reprobate and so implacable that they are past saving. I wouldn't want to be in that situation. In fact, it was because of this sin of child sacrifice to the demon god Moloch that Yehovah of number one told the Israelites to go in, among other this sin and other sins that these Canaanites and these heathens did, to go in and destroy the civilization. They were so murderous and so sexually licentious and so demon-possessed that Yehovah just said, commit genocide. Get them out of there. Because otherwise, they're going to corrupt the land, they're going to corrupt you, they're going to pollute you. They are past redemption. And he brought judgment upon the Jewish nation for sacrificing its children to Moloch. We see this in Jeremiah 7, verses 30 through 34, and Jeremiah 32, verses 35 through 36. And we see there that Baal, and Moloch are the same permutation of the same deity. And the death sentence, Yehovah passed the death sentence and or captivity. They would be taken into another land by another by a conquering nation, in this case the Babylonians, where they would die in captivity. That was the death sentence that Yehovah put upon the Israelites because they themselves had become so sold out to evil that they refused to repent. And so judgment came against them. And I am concerned for a nation, any nation, United States or any other nation, that legalizes or has legalized abortion and has slaughtered tens of millions of its innocent babies, and now it's an acceptable thing in society, acceptable to the heathens at least, not to the righteous people. And I'm very concerned for the judgments that are going to come on that nation if they are not already coming on that nation. And I'm also very concerned for the judgments that are coming on leaders, presidents, kings, queens, members of parliament, members of Congress, judges, that are other political leaders and industry leaders people that are involved nowadays in satanic human sacrifice and child sacrifice rituals, pedophilia rituals, and in using these things to satisfy the lusts of their flesh, these heinous, I don't even have words to describe the pit of hell that many people are living in, murdering, having sex with children and murdering them, or killing the babies and selling the parts, making money off of them, killing children after they have ritually and sexually abused them and selling the parts, and you know, doing demonic rituals. This is prophesied in the book of Revelation to occur in the end times as part of Babylon the Great. Go read Revelation 18. Go read what it says about the whore of Babylon in Revelation 13 and 17. She's been made drunk on the wine or on the blood of the saints and on the blood of people. Spiritually and literally, we have cannibalism going on today in the world. We're starting to see these things come out in the news, in the headlines, and we're starting to see things being leaked out about ceremonies going on among the elites of Hollywood, among the elites in Washington, D.C., that are people that are running for high offices and people that are in great positions of power and influence in our government, involved in these Babylonian, these Baal-worshipping sacrifices and ceremonies where they're worshipping Lucifer and things like this. Don't think it's not going on. Just because somebody looks good on camera and just because they're holding office, they are still human beings, and many of them have been blackmailed, been coerced into these kinds of things, and are now being blackmailed to do the work of our neo-Babylonian puppet masters, and blackmailed so that they, because they have committed these crimes, are now being blackmailed into doing the nefarious work of the Luciferians that run this world, the spirits of Antichrist. It's all over the world. Let us be strong. Let us not hide our heads in the sand, so to speak, and ignore this. It is prophesied in the book of Revelation that it would happen in the end times. Sacrificing children. This is not just something that happened among the Edomites or the Moabites or the Ammonites or the Babylonians or the Canaanites or the Amalekites there in the land of Israel. This has been going on down through the ages, and it happens among the most so-called enlightened people, the most wealthy, the highest elite running world governments. It's been going on down through the ages. That's all I'm going to say about that right now. Y'all have mercy upon the little ones. Y'all have mercy upon those that are being sacrificed and being killed and aborted, being eaten, being dissected, and parts being sold off for money, for sexual pleasure, for spiritual Luciferian satanic demonic power, their blood being drunk. The Bible talks about these things. We like to hide ourselves from it, skip over these things and say, oh, that those are people that happened in the past. No, it's happening now. Read your news. May Yeshua come quickly and bring judgment against these people that are doing this. And Yah protect our little ones from human trafficking that often results in these things taking place. Lord, have mercy. That's all I can say. Now we turn our attention to Leviticus 18, verse 22. One short little verse, but very, very important. In this chapter, Leviticus, there's a lot of sexual sins that are listed, as well as other sins that the Bible calls an abomination, and for which the land will vomit out its inhabitants. One of those sins, not only is, well, some of these sins are adultery, fornication, incest, as well as child sacrifice, abortion. But in verse 20, I also bestiality. The Bible calls these things perversions. And then in verse 22, it says, "You shall not lie with a male as with a woman. It is an abomination. Nor shall you mate with any animal to defile yourself with it, nor shall any woman stand before an animal to mate with it. It is perversion." So these are the most abominable acts and perverse acts, so says the Bible. The word abomination is a word that literally means utterly repulsive to Jehovah, something that is very detestable. It's very strong language. We've talked about that elsewhere. So some people, and let me just say this, in Leviticus 20, verse 13, this command is repeated again. And anytime the Bible repeats itself, you know you need to take attention. Make attention. It's like for emphasis purposes. In chapter 20 of Leviticus, a number of sexual sins are listed among other sins. Adultery, fornication, incest, so forth and so on. Bestiality and the like. But in verse 13 it says, "If a man lies with a male as he lies with a woman, both of them have committed an abomination. They shall be put to death. Their blood shall be upon them." So again, homosexuality carried the death penalty. That's what the Bible says. Can't change that. That's what it says. That is how Jehovah feels about it. And there's a lot of reasons why this is, but I won't get into that. But it is not what he originally intended. He intended for a man and a woman to marry and to have children in the context of marriage as defined by Elohim. One man, one woman. That is how the Bible defines it, and that is how the originator, the inventor of marriage, defined it. Marriage under any other terms or any other definitions is not marriage. It is something else. It's an abomination or a perversion. And I don't care how good the movie star or the singer or the person looks, on how great and powerful they are, it is still an abomination and a perversity. So many proponents of homosexuality who claim to be Christians, they're not, but they say that this verse traditionally has been taken to mean to prohibit homosexuality relating to cultic prostitution. There was cultic prostitution took place in ancient religious situations where there were temple or cultic prostitutes, where the people would involve in a temple prostitution as part of their worshiping of their demonic fertility gods like Baal and Ashtaroth and Astarte and Osiris and Semiramis, Moloch, Diana, these kinds of pagan deities. And yet, this is not what these scriptures in Leviticus 18:22 and Leviticus 20:13 are talking about. It does not say cultic practices here. It is not referring to, yes, it does prohibit any kind of homosexuality, whether it is practiced cultically in a temple or whether it's practice just for pleasure purposes between two people off in their room somewhere. But there's people that are unclear about what this scripture means. Well, the Septuagint clears this misinterpretation up. The Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Torah, and actually the whole Bible, but the original translation was made about 250 BC by a group of Jewish scholars living in Alexandria, Egypt, and they made the Septuagint, or commonly referred to as the LXX, because there were 70 scholars. LXX is the Roman numerals for the number 70. And there, the Greek word is kos an koimete, or methe meta, arsenos koithen gynekos, and that's the Greek, and it literally means as a man having sex with a man as he would a woman. That is how the Septuagint translates it. No mention here of of this referring to merely to homosexual prostitution exclusively, and not including sex between two consenting adults in a so-called loving situation outside of a temple or religious situation. This passage covers all homosexual sex, male and male, female and female, period, no matter what the situation is. And that's what the Septuagint, the translators, understood that to mean. So there is no exclusion for a so-called loving relationship between two men or two women. The Bible is clear. This refers to everyone, every form of homosexual practice. Now, for those that have been involved in homosexuality, there is redemption. There is redemption at the cross of Yeshua. Repent of your sins. Have your sin washed away in the blood of Yeshua. Turn from your sin and walk in the paths of righteousness. There is help for people that really want to do that. But these people who justify themselves by twisting the scriptures, making it look like that this is acceptable, they are ignorant, they do not know the Bible, they do not know the scriptures, they do not know the languages, and they are lying to themselves, and they bought a lie of the devil. And it says here in the Bible, there is no salvation for those who continue in that sin. They will not inherit the kingdom of Elohim. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 9. Do you not know that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of Elohim? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of Elohim. And if you go look up these words, sodomite, or that would be one that submits to a homosexual, or the word homosexual in the Greek refers to a homosexual or a homosexual who's an aggressor, there's no salvation for them as long as they remain in their unrepentant state, living in their sin. But the joy and the hope of this is, and the very next verse says, and this is Paul writing to the believers in the church at Corinth, and such were some of you, but you were washed, you were sanctified, and you were justified in the name of the Master Yeshua by the Spirit of our Elohim. So there is hope. And that is the positive note that I want to leave this difficult subject on. There is hope. But it's predicated on one repenting of their sin. And it's not just homosexuality. I mean, there's drunkenness here, fornication, and a list of other things. Idolaters, you know, some people focus on just the sin of homosexuality, but Paul doesn't make a distinction here that one's worse than the other. Sin is sin. Any sin will keep us away from Yeshua. So we need to repent of our sins, come to Yeshua, turn over a new leaf, go forward, and no longer return to our sin, and live in the power of the resurrected Messiah Yeshua, obeying and conforming our lives, obeying Him and conforming our lives to His commandments. And then we will enter the kingdom of heaven. Hallelujah. There's room and a place at the foot of the cross for everyone. Praise His name. Hallelujah. Amen. Call upon His name. He's near. Yeshua Hashem Behimatzov Kerabu.
Yad Hashem Ki Arbe Yisrael Yeshua Hashem Behimatzo Hashem behimatzo